My name is Tracy Sweeney, child, family, and portrait photographer and owner of Alon Studio in Bristol, Rhode Island. I'm thrilled you're here with me today. I'm going to show you how to add interest and pop to otherwise mundane photos. My goal today is to share with you some new ways to create compelling portraits and hopefully speed up your workflow. So let's go ahead and get started.
We're going to begin with this senior portrait. I photograph a ton of high school seniors, and their images are great examples of how to make them pop using Lightroom and Photoshop, because of course we want to create sort of dramatic, eye-catching images, especially because seniors want to be able to share these on social, and we want to make sure their images, you know, get people to stop their scroll, like their images, etc. You know, all the fanfare that our older adolescents are likely looking for. Now, I shot this image with my 85mm. I shoot all Canon, and this is the native RF lens, 1.2, and I shot it at 1.2 with an ISO of 640. So I was shooting this at sunset at the beach, one of the locations where I shoot quite a bit, and it was still really bright. As the sun was going down, you kind of see there's sort of these cliffs and the sand dunes in the background, but I definitely overexposed the sky here as I wasn't using any lighting, off-camera flash, strobes, etc., instead just using the natural light, so exposing here for the skin. But that's not going to be a problem at all, because we're going to go ahead and take care of all of this and make this a much more interesting image with our tweaks. I'm starting in Lightroom. I'm using Lightroom Classic, and so this version presently, I'm using the 12.5 latest updated release. One thing I want to begin with today is going to be the AI that has been really, you know, prevalent lately, obviously in all of the different technologies, but specifically in photo editing. And I want to begin with some masks. I'm going to go ahead and click on this little icon here, which is going to go ahead and activate our mask options. You'll see that there was a toggle for individual people that will be identified. Now, in this case, we only have one subject, and so she is identified, and we can go ahead and click on person one. And now, within the person one, the technology is offering us an opportunity to then further add a mask for individual features such as facial skin, body skin, eyebrows, etc. And that was all pretty fast, which is so cool, because I can only see this technology getting even more rapid. In this case, I'm thinking about the things that I want to make adjustments to. I'm not going to select entire person, because if I do that, then any tweak I make will then be a global tweak across the subject. This would be fine if I just wanted to increase exposure across the entire subject or something like clarity. But in this case, I want to be more selective in my adjustments. And so I'm going to select just those entities in which I am interested in tweaking. So in this case, it's going to be facial skin. I'm not worried about body skin. There's not any like tan lines or anything else. I'm looking to smooth as far as the body. I'm not worried about the eyebrows in this scenario. I'm not even going to touch the eye sclera, because I don't want to make, they're pretty white, so I don't need to do that. I will select iris and pupil. I'm going to select lips. I'm going to select teeth. I'm not going to select hair. There's a lot I want to do with the hair, but I'm actually going to wait for Photoshop in this case, because I have some windblown hair. That's going to be a better tool for me to work on the hair in Photoshop. I am going to select clothes. Now, you'll notice that this checkbox here says create 5 separate masks. Yes, I do want separate masks for each of those different features I just check marked. So now I'm going to go ahead and hit create mask, and we're going to receive all of these masks here. Now, you can kind of see where the masks are in some of the larger features, such as in the face and such as in the clothing. However, it's harder to see obviously things like eyes, but when you click on the mask, you'll then notice what it is: iris and pupil, lips, teeth, and then clothing. So let's go ahead and just start initially on the facial skin. Now, you can see that the mask here is in red. You can always change that if you wish. Red is fine for me, but if you want to use a different color for your mask, you can always select that here. You can go Shrek style, whatever works for you. I'm fine with keeping it red. And so if you don't want to see that at all, you can go ahead and toggle off of the overlay. And as you make your adjustments, you will then just rely on seeing them. So for example, in this case, if I want to increase exposure, you can tell, obviously it's really crazy and wonky, but you can see the differences that are being made. And so in this case, I'll for the moment just leave my overlay on. What I want to do specifically to her face is to smoothen her skin. There's a variety of different ways of doing this, but for the sake of this lesson, I'm just going to go ahead and adjust the clarity. I'm going to go ahead and bring my clarity to the left to soften things up. And that's really already looking quite fantastic to me. So just went ahead and adjusted the clarity. I want to brighten her face a little bit. I'm going to do that. Again, we have a variety of options. I'm going to increase my shadows a little bit, and I'm actually going to go ahead and brighten my whites just a smidge. That looks pretty good to me. All right. Next, after the skin, I'm going to go ahead and work on the iris and pupil. And in this case, I am going to toggle off my mask because I want to see what is happening with those eyes. She has very, very dark eyes. I want to keep the edit true to the authenticity of the subject. But in this case, because I wasn't using any light, because she's backlit, I feel very comfortable. Just go ahead and increasing my exposure a little bit. I don't want to change, you know, any eye color or anything like that, but I just want to add back a little bit of light. So I'm going to do that with the shadows as well and kind of just brighten those eyes a little bit. And then in this case, I'm also going to go ahead and see if I can try and bring in a little highlight up on the light here. Hopefully you can see that in your monitor, but essentially my entire goal there was just kind of brighten her eyes a little bit because she had no additional, there was no additional light source shining in. All right, next I'm going to go ahead and go on my mask with the lips. Now I don't want to do much here. I'm going to take off that overlay again, but she at the beginning of the session did have some lipstick on. It's kind of faded. We didn't do a reapplication, so I'm just going to go ahead and brighten that a little bit. I'm going to do this with my color temperature. I'm going to add a little bit of tint, just a little bit of magenta, and even a little bit of yellow to kind of mix those two and just brighten those lips a little bit. And that looks good to me. Next, I'm coming back to the mask. Now, the teeth. Her teeth here are just showing a little bit yellow. So what I'm going to do is adjust that temperature by doing the opposite. I'm going to slide to the left. Color temperature, be very careful. A little goes a long way here. So just a little bit of the temperature to the left. And I'm also going to go ahead and increase my whites a little bit. If I tried to adjust just the white, that wasn't going to work. I'll kind of zoom in here. Had I just adjusted the white, it would have just gotten brighter, but not necessarily change the hue. But that looks a lot better. So to kind of let you see where we were and where we are now. Very subtle adjustments, but these individual tweaks are really powerful. And it's going to be a nice opportunity to be able to sync these across like images, which I will show you in a little bit. All right, now the final mask layer I want to adjust is the clothing mask. All I want to do is brighten up her dress just a smidge. I'm going to take the exposure and just brighten up the dress. Not too much so it's not overdone. There we go. And it's pulling a little bit of a blue hue, so I'm going to just warm it up as well by taking my slider to the right. All right, awesome. That looks really, really good to me. So now I'm going to work more on some global edits. I can now return back to my basic panel. You'll notice this is where our masks are, so if I need to return and make any further adjustments, they're still there. But when I click off, I'm back into my basic panel, which is going to allow me to make the adjustments to the image as a whole. So now as I'm looking at the overall image, these are the things that I want to change the entire image. You know, that's the blown out sky, that's the bush background, that's also the subject. I'm going to increase my exposure a bit here. I'm going to go ahead and also increase my contrast a little bit. That looks pretty good to me. And actually, I'm going to go even a little bit more. Yeah, that's a little bit more powerful. Perfect. I'm going to drop my highlights pretty significantly because, again, remember we have that blown out sky. I want to start taking it down some of that brightness. So I'll drop my highlights. However, at the same time, I'm going to open up my shadows. This is going to bring a little bit more light onto my subject. So I'll increase there. And I'm going to drop my whites just to balance everything out. Okay, that's already shaping up really well. I'm not going to do anything with my blocks. That looks pretty good. I am, however, going to reduce my clarity slider. If you've been following me for a while or are familiar with my work, you know I like those really soft and dreamy images, and this is one of the ways in which I achieve that look is by bumping the clarity slider to the left. I know it seems counterintuitive as we typically want sharp images. That's what our eye tends to be attracted to. But in this case, by dropping the clarity, I don't find it affects any of the sharpness of the image. Instead, it just sort of softens everything up a little bit and adds that ethereal effect that I desire. I'm going to go ahead and dehaze this a bit. This slider came out. I'm not even sure at this point. I still kind of think of it as new, but I think it's been quite a few years now. I'm going to dehaze a little bit. And I'm just going to go ahead and pump up that volume. That's really going to help me to pop this color by increasing the vibrance. All right. So that is everything I'm going to do within the basic panel. Those are some of the adjustments I often make to every image. So for myself, I have this as a preset. It's something that, is kind of a basic recipe that I like to use. And it just kind of gives me a foundation for every image from which I can then go ahead and, apply to one image in a batch, sync it across all of them, and start a nice really foundation where the colors are typically where I'm going to want them. So to remind you, here's where we were, here's where we are now, just some slight tweaks, but already you can tell that we have really, amped up the image and made it pop. Here's what's really cool now. If I want to go ahead and sync across like images, I can. What I mean by like images are those other images within the same setting, pretty much the same lighting conditions during the session. For myself, when I'm shooting outdoors, I'm often shooting at sunset during the golden hour, and the light is going to change, especially as I move from location to location, but I will have a series of images that are pretty similar in which I can then batch edit. So I'm going to go ahead and sync these. Here's what's really cool. So you're going to go ahead and get your sync settings, and most of them are going to be preloaded for you. I'm going to add those masks that I just applied with the AI technology for the People Finder, and I'm going to synchronize those across. That's what's really, really cool when you think about it, because those little adjustments I made to the clarity of her skin and the color of her teeth are now going to be in sync on the other images, but they're going to be specific again to those masks. So you'll notice here, if I go to the masks, if I go to the face, those adjustments have already been made. Remember, I went ahead and I reduced the clarity. You'll see that here. I added a little bit into the shadows. You'll see that here. So it's specific to her face, even though she's in an entirely different position than she was in the previous photo. But because of the technology and the face detection, there it was already intuitively, the algorithm was already there to add those adjustments specific to the face, and then to add the adjustments I made, by increasing exposure to her dress, etc. So now what I can do is simply go ahead and add any individual tweaks that might be more specific to this photo. Like this one's a little bit darker than the previous. So now I can go ahead and simply just make those quick tweaks, but I don't have to come back through and add everything I just did. Same thing for the next image. So that's what I find absolutely phenomenal. It's going to speed up your workflow considerably. Even if you find that that first photo is taking a little bit longer, you go ahead and sync your settings. In this case, we have more sand in the background. It's pulling like an aqua. So I'm going to go ahead and pop down here to my HSL panel. That's going to be our hue, saturation, and luminosity. And within the HSL panel, I'm going to just reduce my saturation a bit in the blue. That's going to be, it's not picking up too much blue. Yeah, let's stick with the aqua. So yeah, that should do it. I don't see much of a difference there either. Let's try both. There we go. That looks a lot better. And what that saturation is they're going to be that like intensity of the color, whereas the luminous is giving us that brightness level. So in this case, I just played with both the saturation and the luminance, and that looks really, really good to me. So I think that this is so valuable for a variety of reasons. Obviously, this is taking us a little bit of time. But again, once you get yourself set up and you start moving throughout your galleries, editing in the same fashion, syncing those settings, it really is going to be a tremendous time saver.
I hope I've inspired you to think about new ways to add pop to your portraits. If you'd like to see more of my work, my studio is Alon Studio, and you can find me online at alon-studio.com. On Facebook at Alon Studio, and on Instagram at Tracy_Sweeney. And if you enjoy learning from me, you can check out more of my classes over at kelbyone.com, where I have more in-depth courses on a variety of topics in newborn, child, and family photography. Thank you again, and happy learning to you.